So why is the government's handling of this a debacle when they haven't really done anything?
Well, I mean, that's the first thing, but they could do more. But we're talking about different layers of government, both local government and central government, who have acts of parliament already that should have been protecting these sites. So, for example, Heritage New Zealand, the Māori Heritage Council, and all of these other areas. So the left hand in government traditionally now doesn't know what the right hand's doing. So there is authority under Heritage New Zealand to actually protect, under inference, sites of archaeological and historical significance. So I've sent them an official information act request this morning, and I've asked them, what did you actually know and when did you know it? Because under their Act of Parliament, they are meant to provide licence and approval for development on those parcels of land. So it just so happens this parcel of land in question is the story of the day. But what about other parcels of land? I mean, we only have one site of national significance registered in New Zealand, and they're the treaty grounds. Now, we might be a young nation in terms of human occupation, but in fact we're a very old country. So what is development looking like in the 21st, 22nd, 23rd century, God forbid, and what are we approving to be knocked down? What's on a list and what's off a list? What is a site and what's not a site? And what are New Zealanders wanting to protect?
That makes sense. We want to know what is an historical site. Mm. But the iwi leaders themselves have obviously said that this wasn't wahi tapu because they've allowed Fletchers to go ahead with the development.
Well, yeah, and this is, I come down to the issue of what is a business social licence to operate in a community like that. They went into that community knowing full well that there were problems. The current group that is occupying that site went to the Fletchers shareholder meeting. They bought shares in Fletchers. Sir Ralph Norris, he was the chair at the time, and they protested. They said this is what's going on. And yet what appears to happen, Fletcher Challenge has gone and negotiated something with somebody else. Now, I ask Fletcher Challenge, I ask all business and industry in New Zealand, you know, the ticking of that old brown box is no longer good enough. You know, you might say Katie Pie, well, I say no more Katie Pie. You need to be responsible in how you act with all iwi, all mana whenua related to that land.
Are you implying that there might be private companies out there who are taking advantage of inner iwi conflict?
Well, I think there's always been that. I mean, that's been our stock and trade as a country now for more than 100 plus years. My message to business and industry is simply, you know, the current way of doing business is no longer acceptable. And we didn't need to be here. It's just like the Monaco City Council was on a pathway to have an entire site protected. All of a sudden, the Auckland City Council comes in and completely blasts that out of the water. And now Auckland City Council is saying, oh, forgive us, I'm so sorry, we didn't mean to do things this way. Well, you did do it this way. Monaco City Council weren't fast enough. Central government through Heritage New Zealand haven't been on the game enough. And that's why we need to have a look at reforming this whole setup to ensure that sites both of Māori significance and also all New Zealander significance are protected.
Is there a chance that if the government did respond here and say, OK, this site is special, let's do something about it, let's stop this development, that there could be, this could follow on to many, many, many other pieces of land in New Zealand that are under private ownership that may have been taken illegally, historically?
Well, I mean, this is the new world of Māori Crown relations. I mean, what does this look like? Let's have an honest conversation. Let's put to bed the nervousness that business and industry might face around investing. Let's put private land ownership on the table for a discussion about where these sites might be. And let's have a look at creating a list of things that we can actually protect. Now, protection doesn't mean no development. Protection simply means that there is something important of this site in the life and the fabric of all New Zealanders.
Now, you made a controversial call over the weekend that we need to turn off the tap of immigration and we wouldn't have to develop so much land.
Yeah, I mean, look, one of the driving forces around the development out by the airport is obviously the insatiable demand for housing. So the theory is that the more that we drive into the market, it's going to increase demand, which is going to put pressure on infrastructure, it's going to put pressure on building new houses, wherever those new houses might be. And yet we haven't done any groundwork in better understanding what a future population of New Zealand needs to look like. We've also got more than 500,000 New Zealanders living overseas. overseas, we're not doing enough to attract those skills and that talent and those people back to this country. So I'm not saying turn off the entire immigration tap. We're not talking about, you know, cutting the refugee intake, absolutely not. What we're talking about is let's have an honest conversation about what the population makeup looks like and to reasonably ask the question, if we can't afford to house current New Zealanders, if we can't afford the current health system, if we can't afford food for our children and all of these other things, why are we increasingly bringing even more people in?
New Zealand does need more people in it. We are a small market and we may, as it grows, we'll hopefully grow with it, our infrastructure as well. Also, if we bring the New Zealanders back, they'll need houses.
Well, they will need houses, but they've also got land and houses through family ties and attachments already. So that's not actually a hard question. Look, we get caught up in this migration debate around skilled migration, which are necessary, and unskilled migration to fill seasonal jobs and work. So when you have a look at the skilled migration categories, absolutely there are still skilled migrant categories that we need the inflow to keep coming. Doctors, nurses, obviously teachers, because the Ministry of Education couldn't manage a rat out of a basket with this one. And so what we've got is we've got an entire plethora of skills, though, at the bottom end, that do we really need those skills? Why aren't we using our education system to better build up the skills capability of New Zealanders as opposed to trying to buy them in all the time?
If we do need the skills, which it seems like we do, And a lot of people who hire people say that that they can't find people within New Zealand to fulfil these tasks.
Yeah, I don't agree with that. I'm the former head of the world's largest employment company, Drake, right? So I know this area pretty well, and I hear all those arguments all of the time. So, for example, the IT and tech industry, they say we need more C++ developers, we need more programmers, we need more software developers. Well, OK, I get that. But when they get here, they appear to be driving Uber. They appear to be working as part of the gig economy. Are they coming in to do the skills that the category demands? Or are we having a look at, well, what does an IT future, a digital future, look like in New Zealand? And what could we do in our schools to build that skills base up? Māori, for example, we're part generally of the low-skill, low-wage side of the economy. I want to see our kids flourish into IT. I want them to be software developers. I'd love them to be the next, Steve Jobs. All of these different things. So what are we doing to harness our current potential? So there's a lot of talk around that, but we don't normally factor that into the population debate.
Excellent. Thank you so much for coming in and giving us your time. Matthew Tukaki from the Māori Council.
That is a xenophobic dog whistle, Matthew, and I think you know that. Let's not blame migrants for the fact that we haven't dealt with the issues that have come from our colonisation for a long time. We have parked that. We haven't dealt with it. Immigrants prop up this economy.
No, you get me wrong. I'm not talking about all migrants.
But you're wanting to scale it back.
No, I'm talking about scaling back work visa categories that can be
better filled. Which is migration.
Yeah, well, no, it's not all migration at all. That's incorrect. Absolutely incorrect. Migration is a plethora of both unskilled labour coming through and skilled migration labour as well. So, for example, kiwi fruit orchards and the picking season, we bring in migrant workers to fill that demand.
Yes.
We also have a range of categories over here, doctors, nurses, teachers and that sort of thing. So I ask myself the question, do we really need to be importing teachers? What more could we be doing to develop that skill?
The fact that we have a housing shortage, the fact that we have issues around Ihumātao is not due to migration. It's the fact we haven't built in the right places.
That.
We haven't. Well, you're suggesting that we should pare back immigration.
No, that's not true. That's not accurate. What I'm saying is we need to have an honest conversation about what the population dynamic of this country needs to look like in the future. Well, this is it. What are we as an economy? What skills do we need? What are we doing to build those skills in our current education system? Let's face it, our education system is not fit for purpose for today's New Zealand. We are not producing the skills adequate to keep up to demand. So, in fact, the population debate is sitting over here, but in fact, the education debate needs to be primary in our minds. What skills, capability and capacity do we need? What jobs is business and industry actually creating?
Let's not drag migration into the mix, though. I mean, we have to have
an honest conversation. We have to have an honest conversation about skills.
We should talk about our history. We should talk about our shameful history as a country and the fact that we have not done right by Māori.
Oh, and we're doing that. We're having that conversation. But in order to get to where we need to be, we need to have a conversation about the past, what's happening now, and what the population dynamic of our country needs to be into the future. For example, I'd love to see all 176,000 of our people living in Australia return home.
All right.
You know?
Thanks, Matthew.